Good morning, friends. Myself Dr. Anuradha Sharma, and today we will discuss very important chapter of class 12 biology, biotechnology, its principles and process. I have made these notes from your NCERT biology so that these are helpful for your CBSE exams. Now, first of all, we should know what is biotechnology. Biotechnology, it deals with the technology of using living organisms for products and various processes which are useful to humans, or it can be also defined as application of various techniques to industry, agriculture and environment. So this biotechnology, it is made of two words, that is biology and techniques. So various techniques which when combined with biology and which are useful for humans, it comes under biotechnology. There are various processes like in vitro fertilization, which leads to test tube baby. This is very important technique. In vitro fertilization, it is important for the couples who cannot conceive. In this, there is test tube method. In this test tube, the sperms and ova are fertilized and the zygote is further implanted in the uterus and it can develop into a baby. So this is very important technique, that is in vitro fertilization. Next is synthesizing genes and using technique of DNA vaccine. There are various vaccines which are prepared with biotechnology and these are very helpful in curing various disease. And another technique is defective gene therapy. With this defective gene therapy, we can correct a particular disease which is caused by defect in the gene. So this biotechnology is very important process. The European Federation of Biotechnology has given the biotechnology definition in a different way. They have defined biotechnology as the integration of natural science and organisms, cell parts thereof, molecular analogs or products and services. So these products and services, they are helpful to human beings as they are very beneficial. So we will study what are the main principles of biotechnology. So modern biotechnology is based on two principles. First is genetic engineering and second is bioprocess engineering. As it is biotechnology, that is when biology is combined with technology, so definitely engineering is playing a major role in biotechnology. And genetic engineering means the engineering which involves gene. And gene is the genome, that is DNA or RNA. So genetic makeup of an organism is known as gene. So genetic engineering is defined as direct manipulation of genome of an organism. It involves the transfer of new genes to improve the function or trait into host organism and thus changes the phenotype of the host organism. So this genetic engineering is very important technique of biotechnology. With this genetic engineering, we can improve or correct a particular gene defect which is occurring in an organism. So this gene defect, with this correction of the gene defect, a particular trait or particular disease can be corrected. So this genetic engineering is very important. Now second is bioprocess engineering. Maintenance of sterile condition in chemical engineering process to enable the growth of only desired microbes for the manufacture of biotechnological products like antibiotic, vaccine, enzymes, etc. involves bioprocess engineering. As we know that under sterile conditions, The microbes are grown in labs for manufacture of various products like antibiotics, vaccines, enzymes. These can be grown in small batches or in large amount. So this bioprocess engineering involves this production of antibiotic, vaccine, enzymes, and this process involves biotechnology. Now next is traditional hybridization. What do you mean by traditional hybridization? Hybridization is done to get a superior variety of plants. When we cross two plants, we can get the third plant with the desirable traits, the traits of both the plants. So this traditional hybridization is also technique of biotechnology, and it is used in plants and animal breeding that leads to multiplication of undesirable genes along with the desirable trait. So with this traditional hybridization, we can get the desired trait. Like if we have one plant which is drought resistant, and another plant is having stress-free genes. So we will cross both the plants, we will hybridize both the plants, and we can get the desired traits, both the traits in the third plant. So this technique is done to get the desired trait. So the technique of genetic engineering, which includes recombinant DNA, gene cloning and gene transfer, allow us to isolate and introduce only one set of desirable genes without introducing undesirable genes into the target organism. Now this main technique of biotechnology is recombinant DNA technology, which is also known as RDT. So this RDT is the main technique of biotechnology. With the recombinant DNA technology, we can go for gene cloning, gene transfer, and we can get a desirable gene, and this gene can be introduced into the target organism. Now in a chromosome, we know that a specific DNA sequence is there, which is known as origin of replication. And this origin of replication is the point which is responsible for initiation of replication. Replication, we know that from one DNA, we can get two DNA, multiple DNA copies. That is replication. Multiplication of DNA is replication. So for replication, there is origin of replication which is responsible. Now for multiplication of alien piece of DNA in an organism, it needs to be a part of chromosome which has a specific sequence which is known as origin of replication. Now alien DNA is linked with this origin of replication so that this piece can be replicated. So another technique is cloning. So when we get the desired trait, desired piece of DNA, and it can replicate and multiply in the host organism, this is known as cloning. That is making multiple copies of the DNA template. Cloning means we have multiple identical copies of any template DNA. The construction of first recombinant DNA emerged from the possibility of linking a gene encoding antibiotic resistance with plasmid of Salmonella typhi. So this plasmid was the first of Salmonella typhi, which was used for antibiotic resistant gene. Stanley Cohen and Herbert Boer in 1972, they also isolated the antibiotic resistant gene by cutting a piece of DNA from the plasmid. And this plasmid is a circular chromosomal DNA piece which is autonomously replicating. So this plasmid, which is autonomously replicating piece of DNA, It was found in Salmonella first. Now the DNA at a specific location is cut with the help of molecular enzymes, which are known as restriction enzymes, and these are also known as molecular scissors. These are known as molecular scissors because they are cutting the DNA at a specific location, at a specific point. The cut piece of DNA is then linked with this plasmid DNA. Now these plasmid DNA act as a vector to transfer the DNA attached to it. So these plasmid DNA, they act as vector because they have to transfer the cut piece of DNA into the host organism. Now this further it will transfer it into host organism. Now the linking of the antibiotic resistant gene with the plasmid DNA become possible with the help of enzyme ligase. This enzyme ligase is used for joining the plasmid and the DNA. So this enzyme ligase is useful for joining the cut DNA molecule with the ends. So both the DNA molecules are joined with the enzyme ligase, and this makes new combination which is autonomously replicating DNA in vitro, and it is known as recombinant DNA. Recombinant means it is made up of many portions. The DNA was cut with the help of molecular scissor restriction enzyme. It was further transferred into plasmid. Now it is joined with the DNA piece were joined with the enzyme ligase. So this piece of DNA is known as recombinant DNA. Now this DNA is transferred into the E. coli, and it can replicate using the new host DNA polymerase enzyme, which can make multiple copies. So it has the ability to multiply, and it is to make antibiotic resistant gene, and this is called as cloning of antibiotic resistant gene in E. coli. So the cloning of antibiotic resistant gene was done in E. coli. So this recombinant DNA was prepared with the help of various enzymes, plasmids, and now therefore the technology which is preparing this recombinant DNA, it is known as recombinant DNA technology, or it is also known as genetic engineering, because engineering is done with the help of various molecular scissors, enzymes in gene, that is genome, that is DNA. So this genetic engineering, it deals with the production of new combinations of genetic material in the lab. These recombinant DNA molecules are then introduced into the host cells while they can be propagated and multiplied. So this recombinant DNA is further introduced into the host cells, and it can multiply and form various copies. Now this recombinant DNA technology involves various steps. These steps are as follows. First is identification of the DNA with desirable gene. We have to identify the DNA which is having the desirable genes which we want to transfer. Second is introduction of the identified DNA into the host. We have to introduce this identified DNA into the host organism in which we want to transfer the genes. And third is maintenance of introduced DNA into the host and transfer the DNA into the progeny. So now maintenance is also important because we have to maintain this recombinant DNA into the host so that it can be transferred to its progeny. Now for this technique, that is recombinant DNA technology, these steps are involved. Now apart from these steps, there are various tools which are involved in this recombinant DNA technology. So the tools which are involved in RDT are first restriction enzymes. These restriction enzymes are also known as molecular scissors because these are cutting DNA at a specific point. Second enzymes are polymerase enzymes. Third are ligases. These are used for joining DNA segments. Fourth are vectors. These are used for transferring the DNA into the host organism. And last is host organism in which we want to transfer the genes or correct the genetic defect. So we will study each of these tools in detail. First, we will study restriction endonuclease, that is molecular scissors. The first restriction endonuclease, that is HIN2, this always cuts DNA at a particular point by recognizing a specific sequence of six base pairs. The specific sequence base pair is known as recognition sequence for HIN2. So the specific sequence at which the restriction enzyme is cutting, that is recognition sequence or site. Now these restriction enzymes are named according to a particular criteria, that is the first letter of the name comes from the genus and the second letter comes from the species of the prokaryotic cell which they were isolated. Like example, ECO-R1 comes from Escherichia coli RY. This ECO-R1, it is, the name comes from Escherichia coli RY. ECO-R1, the letter R is derived from the name of the strain. Roman numbers following the names indicate the order in which the enzymes were isolated from the strain of the bacteria. So the R letter comes from the strain of the bacteria. Restriction enzymes belongs to class of enzymes which are known as nucleases. So this restriction enzymes, these belong to broad category of enzymes which is known as nucleases. Now these nucleases are further divided into two classes, that is exonuclease and endonuclease. As the word describes, exonuclease means outside. So this exonuclease removes nucleotides from the ends of the DNA. And endonuclease makes cuts at a specific position within the DNA. So this is the difference between exonuclease and endonuclease, that exonuclease, it removes nucleotides from the ends of DNA, whereas endonuclease, it cuts a specific position within the DNA. So it is endonuclease. Now this restriction endonuclease, it recognizes a specific palindromic nucleotide sequence in the DNA. Now we should know what is palindromic sequence. Palindromes are the group of letters that form the same words when read in both forward and backward direction. Like this is the word, it is same when it is read from this to this direction and here to here. So in this case we can see that this is 5' end and this is 3' end. So this 5' end, we can see that this is, when it is read in this direction, it is GAATTC, and from this it is again GAATTC. It is same in both the direction. So this type of sequence is known as palindromic sequence. The palindrome in a DNA is a sequence of pairs that reads same on both the strands when orientation of reading is kept the same, that is maybe from left to right or right to left. The both Now we will study how this restriction enzyme works. What is the action of restriction enzyme? We can see that ECO-R1, this cuts the DNA between the base pair G and A, and GATTC is present in the DNA. So this is the foreign DNA, and this enzyme cuts both DNA at same site, that is vector DNA. This is vector DNA. This enzyme is cutting at same site. Now we know that this is endonuclease. So this is providing the streaky ends. Now ECO-R1, this sticky end which is produced by this ECO-R1. So this is vector DNA. Now these vector DNA and this sticky ends in the foreign DNA, these fragments will be joined and this will form the recombinant DNA. This is the recombinant DNA which is formed. So this is the diagram showing the formation of recombinant DNA by the action of restriction endonuclease enzyme, that is EcoR1. So restriction enzymes cut the DNA at a little away from the center of phalangrome site between the same two base pair of opposite ends that have sticky ends. The stickiness of the strand facilitates the action of enzyme DNA ligase. DNA ligase is responsible for joining both the sequences. Now, these restriction enzymes are very important. They are used in genetic engineering because they are cutting the DNA at the same site in different genome or different organisms. So when this restriction endonuclease is cutting the DNA, same sticky ends are produced and these sticky ends are further joined by enzyme known as DNA ligase. Ligase means ligation, that is joining. So this foreign DNA is joined with the vector DNA at a specific points with this ligase. In plasmid, this is the DNA sequence. This is joined in the plasmid with the help of this ligase. And further transformation is done in E. coli and the cells divide. And this is the how this recombinant DNA technology works. So this is the diagram showing the recombinant DNA technology, how these restriction enzymes cut DNA sequences. Now this foreign DNA is introduced in the plasmid vector. In plasmid vector, they are joined by enzyme ligase. This ligase is responsible for joining. Now this whole plasmid is transformed into E. coli. These cells divide and multiply and this recombinant molecule is produced. Now this is the agarose gel. Another technique which is widely used in this biotechnology is electrophoresis. Electrophoresis is the movement of charged particle under the electric field. So this agarose gel electrophoresis is used to see the migration of the DNA bands. Here we can see that this is the agarose gel electrophoresis. This is agarose is a polymer. This is agarose gel. These are different wells, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. These are wells which are prepared. Now DNA is introduced in all the wells. The DNA electric field is applied and DNA moves towards the cathode. So the fragment of DNA obtained by cutting DNA using the restriction enzyme is separated by the technique of gel electrophoresis. All this DNA which is introduced by, which is separated by gel electrophoresis. Now as we know that DNA fragments, these are negatively charged particles. So these move towards the anode under the influence of electric field. When we apply electric field here, so these DNA will move towards the anode. And they separate according to size. This DNA will separate according to size through sieving effect, which is provided by this agarose gel. This agarose gel is providing the sieving effect, that is, it is separating the DNA fragments according to the size. Means the heavier DNA will move, the smallest will move fast and largest will move slowly. So it will move according to the size. Now the separated DNA fragments, these can be visualized with staining with ethidium bromide and followed by exposure to UV light. These can be seen with, these are further stained with ethidium bromide and they can be exposed to UV lights. And these DNA fragments can be further seen as orange color bands. So After digestion, we can separate these DNA fragments and they can be seen as orange color. Now the separated bands of DNA, which are separated by agarose gel, these are extracted from the gel with a method known as elution. So the DNA fragments are purified, and in this way they are used for recombination, that is recombinant DNA technology. Now for genetic engineering, there is cloning vector, which is very important. So what are these vectors? The vectors are the DNA molecules that carry a foreign DNA segment into the host cell. Vectors are of two types. First is plasmid and second is bacteriophages. Plasmids are autonomously replicating circular chromosomal DNA segments. And bacteriophages are viruses that are infecting bacteria. Both these vectors are used for transferring the DNA segment into the host and for cloning. Because they are having the ability to replicate within the bacterial cell independent of the control of chromosomal DNA. Now, what is copy number? Copy number is defined as the number of vectors present in the cell, and it can vary from 1 to 100 copies per cell. So the best known vector is plasmid vector. Bacteriophages, because of the high copy number per cell, they are used within the bacterial cell. PBR32 is the first artificial cloning vector which was developed from E. coli plasmid. So this PBR32 is the first artificial cloning vector. Now there are certain features which are required in vector. First is origin of replication. This is very important. Origin of replication is the DNA sequence from where the replication starts. Any piece of DNA when linked to this sequence can be made to replicate within the host cell, and this sequence is responsible for controlling the copy number of the linked DNA. This is the diagram of the cloning vector PBR322. This is in E. coli. So this is the diagram of the cloning vector. We can see that it is having various parts, like various restriction enzymes are present which are cutting at specific sequence, ampicillin, resistinin, and this is origin of replication, that is ORI. This origin of replication is the point where the replication is starting. Second is cloning sites. So this cloning site is linked to the foreign DNA. The vector need to have a single recognition site for commonly used restriction enzyme. So these, as we know that restriction enzyme require a particular site at which it can cut the DNA. So these are the sites which are present in this vector, which is cloning sites. So the presence of more than one restriction site within the vector will generate several fragments which will complicate the gene for cloning. Now the ligation of the foreign DNA is carried out at restriction site in one or two antibiotic resistinin. This ampicillin, tetracycline, this is the antibiotic resistinin. These are restriction enzymes, PST1, PVU1I, BAMH1, these are restriction enzymes which are cutting at specific restriction sites. Now another term is there, which is known as insertional inactivation. The most efficient method of screening the presence of recombinant plasmid is based on the principle that the cloned DNA fragments disrupt the coding sequence of the gene, and this is known as insertional inactivation. This insertional inactivation means that at particular coding sequence it is disrupting the DNA fragment. For example, the powerful method of screening the presence of recombinant plasmid is known as blue-white selection. It is also known as blue-white selection. Now, what is the reason why it is known as blue-white selection? This method is based upon the insertional inactivation of LACZ gene, which is present on the vector. Now, as we know that this LACZ gene encodes the enzyme beta-galactosidase, which can cleave chromogenic substrate into blue-colored product. So, this enzyme is responsible for cleaving the chromogenic substrate and it gives a blue-colored product. And if this LACZ gene is inactivated by insertion of target DNA fragment, the development of blue color will be prevented and it will give only white colonies. So when this is activated, it is giving blue color, and in another case it is giving white colonies. So this is the reason why this method is known as blue-white selection, because it is based on the color, whether we are getting blue color or white color. So in this way we can differentiate recombinant and non-recombinant colonies. If we are getting recombinant colonies, we will get white color, and if there is non-recombinant colonies, we will get blue color. So based on this method, we can differentiate between the recombinant and non-recombinant colonies. Now there are various vectors for cloning genes in plants and animals. In plants, there are different vectors which are used for cloning, and in animals, there are different vectors. Agrobacterium tumefaciens, it is a pathogen of the dicot plant, and we know that it is able to deliver a piece of DNA, which is known as tDNA, to transfer into the normal cell into tumor, and these tumor cells can produce the chemicals which are required by this pathogen. So this tDNA, which is present in agrobacterium, is responsible for transforming cells into cancer cells. Another vector, which is retrovirus, it is found in animals, and it is having the ability to transform normal cells into cancerous cells. Now the tumor inducing TI plasmid of agrobacterium tumefaciens has been modified as a cloning vector with no more pathogenic to the plant. So this TI plasmid, which is found in agrobacterium tumefaciens, it is a cloning vector. Now we have to study competent hosts for transformation with recombinant DNA. As we know that DNA is hydrophilic molecule and it cannot pass through the cell membrane. Hydrophilic, we know that it is not loving in nature. So this DNA is hydrophilic molecule, and because of this property it cannot pass through the cell membrane. Therefore the bacteria should be made competent to accept the DNA molecule, because we have to transfer this DNA into the bacteria and we have to clone it. So this bacteria should be made competent in a way that it can accept this DNA molecule, and this is competency, that is, it is the ability of cell to take up foreign DNA. So competency is the ability of cell to take up that foreign DNA, because DNA is hydrophilic in nature, so it cannot pass through the cell. So how we can make this DNA competent? The cells is made competent by following methods. The cells can be made competent by two methods. First is chemical method and second is physical method. In chemical method, simply chemical treatment is done, that is, chemical treatment is done with divalent calcium ions, which increases the efficiency of the host cells to take up the recombinant DNA plasmid. So this is treated with calcium ions and it increases the efficiency of host cells so that it can take up the recombinant DNA plasmid. Another chemical method is that this recombinant DNA can be transformed into the host cells by incubating on ice and further followed by placing them at 42 degrees centigrade, that is heat shock method, and then putting back on ice. This enables the bacteria to take up the recombinant DNA. So this is another method which is known as heat shock method, means first it is we are incubating it on ice, then we are placing it at 42 degrees centigrade, and further we are placing it back on ice. So this is heat shock method. Second method is physical method. Now there are various physical methods by which we can these cells can be made competent for the foreign DNA. First is micro injection method. In micro injection method, the recombinant DNA is directly injected into the nucleus of the cell using a glass micropipette. Another method is bioelastic, or it is also known as gene gun method. In this, the recombinant DNA is mainly introduced into the plant cells by this gene gun method, and in this method it is the microscopic particles of gold or tungsten are coated with this DNA of interest, and it is bombarded into the cell, as a result of which it is transferred directly into the cell. And the last method which is used is disarm pathogen. Now in this method, the vectors like Agrobacterium tumefaciens, these are allowed to infect the cell and transfer the DNA into the host. So this is another method of to make the cells competent. Now we will study the process of recombinant DNA technology. What are the different steps which are involved in recombinant DNA technology? The steps are as first, very important step is isolation of DNA. How we have to isolate the DNA from the cell. Second is fragmentation of DNA by restriction endonuclease. We have to cut the DNA at a particular site with the help of molecular scissors, which are also known as restriction enzymes. And third is isolation of the desired DNA fragments. Now the desired DNA fragment is first further isolated. Fourth is ligation of DNA fragment into the vector. Once the DNA fragment is isolated, now we have to join this DNA fragment into the vector. Next is transforming the recombinant DNA into the host. Next step is culturing the host cells in the medium at large scale. So we have to culture the host cells in a particular medium at large scale so that we can get the desired product. And last and final step is extraction of the desired product. How we can extract that protein or desired product from the cell. So we have to study all the different steps in detail. First, we will study how this isolation of genetic material DNA is done. This genetic material is isolated from macromolecules by using various enzymes, like lysozymes is used in case of bacteria. In plant cells, cellulase enzyme is present. Fungus chitinase enzyme is present. These are used for isolation of the DNA fragments. DNA can be separated by spooling. Now the RNA can be removed from the cells with the help of ribonuclease enzyme, and proteins are further removed with the help of protease enzyme. So different enzymes are present for different substrate, and these can be used for isolation of the genetic material. This is the diagram. We can see that spooling, how this DNA is being separated, and this is removed with the help of spooling. So next step is cutting the DNA at a specific location. This DNA needs to be cut at a specific location, and this has to be done with the help of restriction enzyme and AgroGel electrophoresis to check the progression of the restriction enzyme digestion. Now after cutting the sources of DNA as well as DNA with a specific restriction enzyme, one gene of interest from the source of DNA. So we need, so this DNA is cut with the help of restriction enzyme or digested, and this digestion can be checked with the help of AgroGel electrophoresis.
And as we know that DNA is negatively charged, it will move towards the anode. And this separation can be done on the basis of molecular weight.
Further,
another step is amplification of the gene of interest using PCR. PCR is a very important technique which is used in biotechnology, and PCR stands for polymerase chain reaction. Now this PCR is done to amplify a particular gene product. We can amplify a DNA segment by using PCR. So this
PCR
has
basically three
steps.
First is denaturation.
As we know that DNA is double-stranded, so this DNA is denatured
by subjecting it to high temperature, that is 95 degrees centigrade, for 15 seconds. So if we want to
amplify the DNA, this DNA, both the strands of DNA need to be separated. And so denaturation is the first step in which it is subjected to high temperature so that both the strands can be separated. And the strand can act
as template for the DNA synthesis. Second step is primer annealing. In this PCR, two sets of primers are added which anneal to the 3' end of the separated strands. So these primers act as the initiators for replication. So two sets of primers are used which anneal at the 3' end, and these primers start the replication process. Third step is extension of the primers. DNA polymerase extends the primers by adding the nucleotides complementary to the template provided in the reaction. This DNA polymerase enzyme, it is very important, and there is a particular reason why it is used in this PCR, because this enzyme is isolated from Thermus aquaticus. This enzyme is very thermostable at high temperature, and this is the reason why it is used in this polymerase chain reaction, because it remains active during the high temperature induced denaturation of the double-stranded DNA. Because when we are applying high temperature, this enzyme does not get deactivated. So the process of replication of DNA is repeated many times to get 1 billion copies. So this PCR is basically done to amplify the gene product so that we can get multiple copies of the DNA segment in a single technique. And this technique basically involves three steps. This is the diagram which is showing the polymerase chain reaction. Here we can see, first it is denaturation of double-stranded DNA is done. DNA is double-stranded so that it can, both the strands can be separated. So it is heated at high temperature so that both the strands can be separated. Further, primers are applied and primers bind to the 3' end. And further, tap DNA polymerase is used with deoxynucleotides so that it can amplify the DNA fragment and replication can occur. And it can be amplified to 1 billion copies. So this is basically done to amplify the DNA fragment. Now next step is insertion of this recombinant DNA into the host cells. Once we have obtained this recombinant DNA, we have to insert this recombinant DNA into the host cell or other organism. It includes making the recipient copies competent to take up the DNA present in its surrounding cells. So this recombinant DNA has to be transferred to the host organism. And this recombinant DNA bearing gene for resistant to antibiotic, it is transferred to the E. coli cell, and the host cell becomes transferred into ampicillin resistant cell. So the only ampicillin resistant gene In this case, it is known as selectable marker because it is present in the host cells. It is present in the E. coli cell. So only the transformed cells will grow on the agar plate, which contain ampicillin transformins, and other cells which are not containing the ampicillin genes will die. So this is method of insertion of recombinant DNA into the host cell. Now next step is obtaining the foreign gene product. The foreign DNA multiplies in the plant or animal cell to produce desirable protein. Now the expression of these genes in the host cell involve optimized condition to obtain recombinant protein. Once these cells are going on the medium, definitely our purpose is to obtain a particular product or a particular protein, which is recombinant protein. Now, when a protein encoding gene is expressed in a heterologous host, it is known as recombinant protein. So this is the recombinant protein which we have to obtain from the host cells. Now the cells having the gene of interest can be grown on small scale or large scale. Now if our purpose is to obtain the recombinant protein, so this recombinant protein can be obtained by two methods. We can grow the cells having the gene of interest on small scale, or we can grow it in large scale. On small scale, the cells are grown on culture in lab, and then the expressed protein is expressed and purified by different separation techniques. So if we want to obtain this protein on small scale, we can go for lab. We can grow a culture in the lab and we can extract a particular protein. But if we want to obtain this recombinant protein on large scale, like if we want to obtain a particular antibiotic or drug for medicinal use, we have to obtain it in large scale. So for large scale, the cells are grown in a continuous culture system in which the medium is drained from one side while the fresh medium is added on the other side to maintain the cells in the physiological active phase, and the desired protein can be collected on other side. So for large scale, there are continuous culture system in which we can place medium from one side and we can obtain the desired product from the other side. For this, the bioreactors are there. Now bioreactors are the vessels of large volume, that is 100 to 1000 liters, in which the raw materials are biologically converted into specific products. So for large scale, we have to use bioreactors, which are vessels of large volume, maybe thousands of liters, and in which the raw material can be converted into a specific desired product. For this bioreactor, optimum conditions are necessary for achieving the desired products, like growth conditions, temperature, pH, vitamins, oxygen, etc. The most commonly used bioreactor are of stirring type. So stirring type is the most commonly used bioreactor, which is used for various purposes like antibiotics, vaccines and other products also. We can see this is the diagram of the bioreactor. This is simple stirred tank bioreactor and this is part stirred bioreactor. So these are the bioreactors which are having foam breaker, flat bladed culture broth, motor, acid base, pH is maintained, and sterilization is also there. So all the basic conditions are near, and these conditions are very necessary to obtain the desired product under sterile condition, because we want a product in the pure form. So this product is obtained under sterile condition. The bioreactor has following parts like agitator system, an oxygen delivery system, foam control system, pH system and sampling ports, so that small volume of cultures can be withdrawn periodically. So after obtaining this desired product, this product is now ready for marketing, and this process is known as downstreaming process. So downstreaming process involves the processes that make the product ready for marketing, and this includes various steps like separation of the product from the reactor. After separation, once we have separated a product from the reactor, we have to purify the product. So second step is purification of the product. Third is formulation of the product with suitable preservatives. We have to add suitable preservatives so that a product can be used for a longer duration. And fourth is quality control testing and clinical trials. So this is also very important, that quality control testing and clinical trial is done in case of many drugs before coming into the market. So please subscribe my channel and press the bell icon to get more videos.